in the Middle East.
Covenant.
Yeah. We're about to take a closer look at that. The covenants themselves, there are 8 major covenants in the scripture. And so let's get a definition going here. It's a Middle Eastern compact between two parties made by cutting and passing through flesh. So what happens? The two parties are going to make this agreement. Maybe, let's say, over water rights, the one guy owns land on one side of the river, the other guy owns land on the other side of the river, and they both have large flocks. Well, this is going to set the agreement as to who waters their flocks when. So they take one of their lambs or sheep, and they slit its throat, bleed it out, and then they cut the animal in half. And the blood is going to be running down from the two sides of the animal into a pathway. And then they walk through the blood. They get the blood on their feet and their shoes, likely slopping up onto the bottom of their robes or whatever. Now, what are they saying with that? Well, hopefully that'll become obvious. God always works through covenant when he's in relationship with people. Always. Covenants are permanent and eternal. Once you enter covenant, you never get out of covenant.
Never to be broken.
Never to be broken. There are consequences for breaking covenant, which we'll get to. A covenant is not like a contract. In America, if two businesses make a contract, okay, so one guy defaults on the contract, he has to pay money or whatever, and the contract is canceled. Not so with covenant. Covenant's passed down through families. So, two men are in covenant with one another. What happens? A covenant gets passed down to their sons. Their firstborn son, actually. You don't make a covenant, you cut a covenant. And the animal is the cutting item. The shedding of that animal's blood seals the covenant. Therefore, if you break a covenant, guess what happens to your blood?
You're dead.
You're dead. Your blood gets shed. Bedouin tribes in Israel and in that area of the world still make these, cut these covenants. And when you're talking about the sharing of water to water your herds or grazing land for your animals, this is a very serious thing. Okay? The consequences for covenant breaking are severe, require the life of the covenant breaker or the life of his firstborn son, his primary inheritor. I'm giving you a little time to write. So now we're ready on the symbols of covenant.
Not yet? Do you need more time?
Do I need to back up for you? I'm glad to do that.
Just holler if we go too fast.
Here, I backed up. It will say this later on, I think, in this particular presentation. The word covenant and the word testament are the same word. So what do we have in our Bible? Old covenant, new covenant. Or let's say it better, first covenants, plural, final covenant. First covenants, second or final covenant. Okay? Are you starting to get the idea that this might have something to do with Jesus? Yeah, it sure does. Okay, is everybody good to move ahead now? Give me a nod or a shake so I know. We're good? Okay, here we go. We've already stated blood shedding accompanies the cutting of a covenant. You take an animal and you cut it from nose to tail, cut it in half, and it bleeds out on a pathway and you walk through the blood. Circumcision was part of the covenant God made through Abraham, which is also a cutting of flesh and shedding of blood. Took 7 days for them to heal from it. So are God's agreements with Abraham, are they ever going out of play? No, never. What about the covenants that God made with Noah? Same thing. No, they're always going to be in place. That's why you still see rainbows. Was the covenants, the two covenants God made with Adam and Eve and the covenant he made when they left Eden, were those permanent? Absolutely. Blood sacrifice, animal cut from nose to tail, walking through pieces of flesh, sealed the death penalty for the breaking of the covenant. So both parties already knew this is what would happen if they break the covenant. I'll go ahead and put the rest of the screen up and then give you a few minutes to write. Altar and sacrifice. The altar, a pile of stones, was to be a memorial, a reminder, physical reminder of a spiritual truth, a physical reminder that they were in a condition of blood covenant. And the blood of the animal sacrificed on the altar was then a reminder that sealed the covenant. One of the things we'll look at is the temple. What was the first thing you encountered when you went in the front? The altar of sacrifice. And that animal being sacrificed was a reminder that they were in a permanent, eternal, covenantal agreement with the Creator of heaven and earth. Therefore, the item that was in the innermost room was called the Ark of the Covenant. That's where God's presence dwelt when the high priest one day a year would come in on the Day of Atonement. There was a process where two men being in covenant would cut their arms and intermingle their blood, signifying or symbolizing oneness. You are now me, I am now you. The wound would be a permanent sign on their body that they were in covenant with, like David and Jonathan. They were in this covenantal relationship. Okay, when you've caught up, give me a nod and we'll move ahead.
Where did all this originate?
Karen asks, where did this all originate?
People do this before Abraham was gone.
Can I give you my opinion?
Yeah.
Because there's discussion on that. Garden of Eden.
Mm-hmm.
What happened in the Garden of Eden? Well, Adam was lonely. Right? All the animals had partners, not him. And so what happened? Oh, God cut him. Now, the Jewish rabbis, many of them will say, he didn't take a rib out of the guy's side. That might have been painful enough. He put him into a deep sleep and cut him in half. And half of him became the woman. The other half remained Adam. So when people throw this phraseology around, where's your better half? That's probably biblically, literally correct.
Boy, that's new to me.
So what you want to figure out is who got which parts.
No comment.
Yeah, that's good that the pastor is going to retain his speech patterns here. Do you suppose there was blood involved when he cut Adam in half?
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Separating of flesh? Uh-huh. Was that before sin? Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And there are some very serious thoughts that you might want to process when you consider that. Was that marriage ever to be broken?
No.
No. Those kinds of things. Mm. How come it wasn't Adam and Steve? Or Susie and Priscilla, I don't know. Pick your names. By the way, when you begin denying the creation, that's what leads you to those kind of fallacious assumptions. More symbols, here we go. There would be a covenant meal when a covenant was established. You can see this when Jacob fled from his father-in-law, and the father-in-law cut up to them at where they set the boundary line, and they had a covenant meal. Covenant meals are still in being practiced today, and so when you sit down to meal with someone, in a sense, you are sharing a covenantal experience with them. So what does the covenant meal say? I am ingesting you. You are ingesting me. We are becoming, on a very literal sense, one. I am drinking you. And so what always accompanies the covenant meal? Bread and wine. Does it sound familiar? The Passover? Does that sound like our communion ceremony, which got taken from the Passover Seder? There would often be exchanging of gifts of joy, a reminder of the covenant. Our rings at a wedding ceremony are a derivative of that. There would be name changes involved. For example, when God established his secondary stage of the covenant with Abraham, Abram was his original name, Abram. Sarai was the wife's name. They became what? Abraham, Sarah. God placed in their name part of his name from the name Yahweh. Okay? So that's where we get the idea of women taking on the name of their husband. There's more to say about that I won't get into today. But did you ever notice how many names in the Bible either end with E-L or A-H? You ever notice that? Azariah. Mishael. Daniel. The L from Elohim. The A-H from Yahweh. And many, many Jewish names end that way with those two suffixes. I think that's what you call them.
Can I add the third one, which is if it's an AI, that's from Adonai.
Oh, yeah, AI, Adonai. Sorry. Oh.
No, that's fine.
A little short on that one there.
Sarah. No.
The purpose of this whole thing is to end up showing what? Oneness. Family or tribal unity. Have you ever heard that Gentiles are now able to be grafted in, adopted into the Jewish heritage? You ever heard that? Romans 9, 10, and 11? That is a covenantal thing that God has done. And by the way, hope anytime you have anything to add like that, jump right in there. Mm-hmm. That's how Pastor Lee and I are working with his Daniel study. Okay. The AI at the end of some names is from Adonai. By the way, Elohim, Yahweh, and Adonai are three key names of God in the scriptures.
There are hundreds of names, but those are the big three.
The big three. And Adonai
three big names for something.
Is actually kind of a scary one. Because the name Adonai means the all-powerful, the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. Judy, prophecy is rooted in God's character expressed in that name. Okay?
Elohim,
yeah, the great creator God. And Yahweh, the God who saves. Have you ever heard the name Yeshua? Yeah, it's taken from the name Yahweh.
Yahweh, Yeshua, or Joshua.
Joshua.
Yoshua and Yeshua. Yep.
That becomes very important when you study the book of Zechariah, for example. Okay. So all you tribal family friend members who enjoyed a covenant meal with us today, we didn't have bread and wine. Donna asked about doing that maybe at the next class. And I'll think about that. I can tell you this, anybody going on the tour, that's how we end the tour. And we've generally celebrated the bread and wine covenant symbols in the Garden of Gethsemane. And it is, very moving experience. Sorry.
I'm so excited for you.
There would often be exchange of personal items when they cut the covenant. It could be a thing like a hat or a robe. In other words, I am now wearing the other person. If you put on another person's robe and you went into their herds, their lambs would recognize the smell of the owner of the robe. You know, you can't fool animals, except like that. A bow or a sword, military weaponry. Your friends now become my friends, and your enemies now become my enemies. Now think about that with Jesus.
Mm. If he is with me, who is against me?
I'm sorry, who?
If God is for me, who can be against me?
Yeah.
Right?
That makes sense now?
Is there any reason why the Lord chose to use a rainbow to establish his covenant? Because the bow of the rainbow is meant to be a mirror image of an actual bow and arrow. And if the arrow is pointing straight up, who is the arrow pointing towards? The God Almighty, to make sure that his words are held true. So anytime you see a rainbow, it's meant to remind you of his promises. Mm-hmm. I think it's pretty awesome.
I will never leave you or forsake you. A belt, that's a weaponry belt to protect the reproductive organs of a man. Mm-hmm. And that is saying that your covenant partner is obligating all of their strength to you. What a promise from Jesus. I have often gotten the impression in church that I just need to choose right. I just need to do the right stuff. And I worked with that for a long time. I found out it didn't work very well. Because I found out deep inside I'm kind of a nasty guy. It wasn't until I understood that the Holy Spirit was God's exchange gift to me. And it was the Holy Spirit who equipped me to be able to do what was right. Covenantally, all of this began to change in my life. You know, I've heard people say, oh, that so-and-so is a pretty good guy. Not. We're all broken. But now that you realize you have a covenantal partner who has promised his Spirit to live within you, and we're going to look at that more closely when we study the temple. That is a huge, big deal. Yeah, Chris?
One thing I was just thinking, and if you're going to talk about it, I apologize, but even with the ceremony and the cutting of the covenant, and just like what Hope was saying, what even these things symbolize and represent, you can talk about when Genesis 15, when God puts Abram to sleep, because who walks through the dead carcasses?
Yeah.
It's not Abram. So when even God swears a covenant to Abram, Abram is not the one who's on the line for it. God is.
God passed through the parts in two forms. What were they?
Smoke and fire.
Smoke and fire, right? Does that sound familiar? Day of Pentecost? Flames of fire? Mighty roaring wind? Tornado?
What's always amazing about that is that it's not like Abram does his end of the bargain, God will do his, like what you're saying. I've got to do the right thing.
Yeah.
Abram doesn't walk through the pieces. God swears by himself.
If
he's not faithful to what he says he will do, may he be done like these carcasses have been done.
Good. How many of you know the story of God coming to Abraham and saying, take your son Isaac, your only son, whom you love, up to Mount Moriah and sacrifice him? All right, are you familiar with that story?
Yeah.
That's cruel. Why did God tell him to do that?
That he would put his trust in God.
Because Abraham broke the covenant. He told a local king that his wife Sarah was his sister. And that king took Sarah into his harem. That's why Abraham never argued. He knew he was dead guilty. Now, I think there's a second element to that, and this is something you may want to begin watching for in the lives of biblical characters. Here's Abraham. He didn't tell Sarah where they were going. Did you notice that? Smart guy. What did he say to the servants? We will worship and then return. Abraham believed that somehow God was going to resolve this. The book of Hebrews, it says he believed that he was going to raise Isaac from the dead, which in a sense he actually did. But he got up there, all the way up there, had the knife raised, and then God intervened. Right? And there was a lamb in the thicket. Did you know that Mount Moriah is where the temples stood? 300 yards from the current temple platform is where Jesus was crucified on the cross, on Mount Moriah. God's got this whole thing figured out. Sorry, I get emotional when I talk about this stuff. Now we come to the terms. There were two forms. There was the long covenant. Each party was given a copy of the covenant for storage in a safe place. So where was the covenant God made with Moses, the first five books of the Bible? Where was it stored? It was in the Ark of the Covenant, and God's presence was sitting on the lid. Okay, go ahead, try and take that one away from him. Right? And then there was a thing called the short covenant. It's a short summary of the covenant terms issued to each party for public display at their house.
Or tent.
Or tent.
Yeah.
So what's the short covenant?
Ten Commandments.
What's the long covenant? The Torah, the first five books. And I could show you very clearly that it wasn't just a behavioral covenant, the long covenant. It was also a marriage contract covenant. This whole thing is just beautiful and amazing. So what's our long covenant? The New Covenant Testament. Yeah, that's our covenant. What's our short covenant? Jesus said it was summed up in two things. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, strength, and mind. And the second is like it. Love your neighbor as you love yourself. See, Jesus was living out all of this. Okay. Now for some interesting facts. The covenants are generally cut between a superior and an inferior, a more powerful and a less powerful. Can you agree with me that your covenant with Jesus meets that qualification? Yeah, absolutely. Occasionally you'll find a covenant between equals binding the two together. But you don't see that very often. By the way, in regard to that, the superior establishes the terms. And the inferior person has no say. Does that meet the qualifications of your relationship with Jesus? Very interestingly, in the book of Deuteronomy, and I think it's chapter 24, Moses allowed for a thing called a writ of divorcement. Did you know that God got divorced? He divorced the Jewish people. Where is the divorce writ listed? In Isaiah 50? Where were you when I produced this writ of divorcement for your mother? It's very clear. But you know what it says down in? Because it was temporary. The divorce was temporary. Down in it says, I offered my back to those who beat me. They pulled out my beard. They spit on me. Who bought back the marriage covenant with the Jewish people? Jesus did. And then, miracle of miracles, wonder of wonders, he allowed us to be a part of it. What an incredible thing. Okay. Here now are the eight major covenants. There are two of them in the first picture. So, okay, what's this? Adam and Eve and being expelled from the garden. There are two covenants there. You notice that Adam and Eve tried to cover themselves with fig leaves, which didn't work out too well. So what did God do? He took the skins off of animals. Now, I don't think the animals were running around skinless after that. I think they were dead. So it's the first example of animal sacrifice. Then who's this?
Noah.
No, I found that picture on the internet, and there was a caption under it that says, Noah, you got to do something about those woodpeckers. That was great. So, what's that? Who's this?
Abraham
and Isaac, yeah.
Moses.
Go ahead. Moses. What's this?
Israel.
The land covenant. When God made his promises to Abraham, his guarantee of it was the land. I will give this as a permanent possession to you and your offspring. That's one of the reasons I support the Jewish people being established back in their land. It's the fulfillment not only of that covenantal promise by God, but it's a fulfillment of multiple predictions throughout the prophets in the Old Testament. Okay, who's this guy? King David, yep, the Davidic covenant. One of your descendants will sit on your throne and will rule the world in righteousness forever. Which leads to this one. What's this one? Somebody said it. New covenant, Jesus. So I'm going to list them now. The Edenic covenant, care of Eden. I should have put marriage in there because the standards for marriage are set there, and Jesus actually refers to it when he was asked about marriage one time. So then you have the Adamic covenant, conditions for the curse for Adam, Eve, and Satan. Very interesting things said there. The Noahic covenant, conditions for human and animal interaction after the flood. The Abrahamic covenant, man of faith, that becomes the basis of a relationship with God, and that is hugely important. Mosaic covenant, Israel chosen as a priesthood to the nations. And I'm going to give you a scripture on that. Exodus 19, verses 5 and 6. Of all the nations on earth, you are my treasured possession. I'm choosing you this day to be a nation of priests and a holy people. Those were the two conditions. So why did God give them the Torah, the 613 commands? It was to produce a pure priesthood. How did they live up to it? Not too well. So what is our covenantal command? Go into all nations, preach the gospel, teaching, making disciples, and baptizing. How's the church done with that one? Not too hot. The world population is now growing faster than we can reach people. So before we begin casting aspersions at the Jewish people, we need to think about how we've done. Then you have the land covenant. God's holy land is given to the Israelis. Davidic covenant about his descendant who would rule the world in righteousness forever. That's yet to happen. And the new covenant, forgiveness. And the Holy Spirit provided all by faith. So now I'm going to ask you a pointed question. Can you lose your salvation?
No.
Not when you're in covenant, you cannot. And if you don't get anything out of this from a spiritual vantage point, this discussion on covenant, I hope you get that one. Did you know in the divorce decree in Deuteronomy 24, only the husband could divorce? Now, if Jesus purchased us, then we've been bought with a price, as it says in 1 Corinthians 6. Is he ever going to divorce us? Nope. I think that's awesome truth. I presented that in India one time when I, in fact, presented this presentation there. And there was a guy there visiting that one day at the mission station where we were working. He was from a country, he was an American, was serving as a missionary in a country in Africa. And he sat there and listened to it. And at the end, he put his hand up and said, "Are you saying that you can't lose your salvation?" And I kind of laughed a little. I said, "Well, I know people fight over that one." But I said, "Once you understand covenant, the answer is no." And he was a big, huge guy, about 6'6 or 6'7. Came up and gave me a bear hug afterwards. I thought he was going to break my ribs. And he said, "I've been looking for that answer my whole life." Never forget that. What a time. Okay. Everybody good?
Yep.
I have to say a special thanks to Kay Money, part of the manual. She talks about covenant, and it's very, very important in the cultural context of the Israeli people. Will God redeem his people someday? Yes. Does it matter if they're stubborn and obstinate and difficult and nasty and mean? Nope. Our God's hands are not tied. Does it matter if you're mean and nasty and stubborn and ornery? Nope. God will get it. Trust me on that one. Okay. We're going to take another quick break. And then, Hope, did you have a comment? Or?
Nope.
All right. When you come back, we'll head into our last discussion.
Awesome.
Thank you. In the audience, who I will not mention their names.
Tim Single.
So I want to begin with a question. Is the Bible in chronological order?
No.
No. Well, how is it organized? Oh, yeah? Karen says by subject. What's first? Called? It's called the Torah by the Jewish people. Well, and it's called the Pentateuch by Gentiles. Penta meaning five. Right, or the law. And I already told you how many laws there are. 600 and how many something? 613.
Yeah, Congress.
You may want to write that up at the top where it says Tanakh, that stands for the Torah, the history, and the writings. So, why did they put the law first? We're going to keep you turkeys in line. Is that what that's about? All right, in the Jew. Yeah? First preacher?
God revealed all this directly to him.
Yeah, that's also true. Why the law first? Okay, in the Jewish mindset, better to stand before God and know what he expected than to stand before God and not know what he expected. Do you get the thinking? All right, so that's why the law is first. Then what's next in the Old Testament? Nope.
No, history.
History, very good. And one of the things I did when I taught Bible at CVCA, I would make the students turn to the table of contents and actually label the segments of the Old Testament, First Testament. So you may want to do that. So, which books are in the history section? Oh yeah, you missed a couple.
Joshua, Judges.
Oh, Joshua through.
Feel free to cheat and look at your Bible before.
You can open up the table of contents and look. I'm not. I mean, you already got a couple of people cutting to the end anyhow. Not mentioning any names, of course. Joshua through. You said it once and then you skipped. What is the last book of history? Esther. And that's actually the last book of the Old Testament, historically. So Joshua through Esther, those are the history books. Whose history? History of Israel. How come they get their history? I'm French, Swiss, and German. They should put my history in there. Chosen for what? Karen says they're God's chosen. Chosen for what?
To share God with all the nations of the world.
To be a priesthood to the nations and a holy people. Yes? Which the stories go on, they didn't do too well with all that, but that's the point of it, yes? All right. So that's why it's Jewish history. By the way, I don't know if any of you noticed this, you know all our studies about the land, the geography, and so forth? Have you figured out that God put his chosen people, the priesthood, in the land bridge that connected the continents?
What?
I mean, like, did you notice that? What a brilliant move by God. Anybody try? God put his priesthood, the Jewish people, in the land bridge that connected Mesopotamia, Asia, Europe, and Africa. So anybody traveling from any of those three outer regions had to pass through this land where the people dressed weird, they ate weird, which is what we just experienced. And the weirdest thing of all, they had a temple with no statue in it. They say, well, where's your God? Oh, he's invisible. What? Boy, does that have implications in the scripture? God may have been invisible, but was he powerful? Did he work? Did he work in spite of people often? Yes. What do you learn about that spiritually in your life? He may not be able to be seen, but he's going to be at work.
You know, another application is to just personally look at, where is God placing you? That may not make a lot of sense, but boy, you have a lot of traffic in your life. You got a lot of people coming and going in and out of your life, and you might be the only Jesus they ever get to see. Mm-hmm.
Yep.
He might be doing this very thing of putting you on a global toll road, and you are a priesthood to those people.
Yep.
That might be crazy to say that, but I can tell you that's true in my life.
Been true in mine. Last thing I ever wanted to be was a school teacher. So there's God laughing for 47 years. Okay. Karen, we're back to you. What's next?
Poetry.
Yes, poetry. Mr. Bischoff's favorite area. And what's next?
Major
profits. That must mean they made a lot of money. Oh. Yeah, they're major profits, Diane, because?
The books are longer.
Their books are longer.
That's it.
Number five.
Minor
profits. That doesn't mean they were digging coal either. Okay, so now we come to our little chart you have here, and I'm going to tell the two people who tried to jump my project to wait for other people. So, what's first? What event? Don't all answer at once.
Creation.
Oh, creation, yeah, absolutely. And we're going to go by the Orthodox Jewish calendar on this. Give me a year.
Zero. 4,000.
Somebody said 4,000. I'll buy that. By the way, I'm trying to think. I think the lady's name is Dr. Mary Schweitzer. Are anybody familiar with her work on soft tissue found in dinosaur bones? Oh, Ray's familiar with it. Yeah, she works with Jack Horner in the Hell's Creek excavations where they're digging up dinosaur bones. And they dug up this one T-Rex. The leg bone was so long it wouldn't fit on the truck. So they cut it in half. And she took it back. Well, it's already cut in half. So she decided to see what she would find. She put some of the stuff out of the inside of the bone.
Marrow,
yeah, and it put it in acid. And it was in there for about 3 weeks. And when she got done, there was soft tissue in it. And she's like, I must have done something wrong. This is impossible. This bone is 6 million years old. There couldn't be anything soft in there. Did the experiment several more times, came up the same thing every time. What they now believe, not her and not Jack Horner, but what other scientists now believe is the oldest that bone could possibly be is 6,000 years.
Which fits.
Look at the time frame.
Seriously? What?
6,000 years ago. Maybe your Bible is a lot more accurate than what you think. Interesting, huh?
I don't.
Okay, so the next thing is the flood. I'm going to give you two possibilities on that one. No, I think the fall happened right close to creation. I don't think Satan was willing to wait a split second longer than God would allow him. See, we were put on this earth to take his place.
Mm-hmm.
And he's madder than mad. Okay, so flood. Come on, somebody give me a year. No wimping. Guess if you have to.
2,000?
2,000? It's not quite far enough.
3.
It's a little too far.
25.
The actual number I'd give you is probably at the museum, the Ark Museum down in Kentucky. They put it at 2750,
But they have other evidence, and I don't have the evidence, so I'll go with somewhere between 3,000 and 2,500. Okay? Who's next? Karen says Abraham, and I agree. Give me a year, Karen.
2,000.
Yeah, I'll buy 2,000 on that one. By the way, Abraham left a city in Mesopotamia called Ur. That wasn't because his car was hard to start.
The dad jokes are only going to get worse if you encourage it.
Okay. They know that Ur was destroyed right around 2000 BC. 1996 is actually the year that they put on it. And so I think God told Abraham to get out of town. That civilization, the Sumerian civilization, was grossly evil. Okay? And I think that's why God destroyed the city. But I think he told Abraham, his man of faith, to get out of town first. Next we have, and the event is the Exodus, yeah. Year?
1500.
If you want to say, if you want to be a real detailist, 1406, yeah.
Where did you pull that out of?
Now, that's getting low. See what I'm saying?
It's cable.
Yeah, we'll give you 1500. Now, how do we know 1406? Well, here's how we know. We know for sure the date that Solomon dedicated the temple. And it says clearly in that chapter, in, I believe, 2 Chronicles, I have to look it up, that it was 480 years after the Exodus. So when you do your math, you subtract years for the 40 years of wandering, come up with 1406. Okay, so now what's next?
The kings.
Donna?
The kings.
Yeah, the kings. Name the three kings of the United Kingdom, class.
Saul.
I was just about to say that.
What?
Great mind.
One more time.
Saul.
David. Solomon. Kings of the United Kingdom. And we know for sure that David was king during the year 1000. Each of the kings, Saul, David, and Solomon, ruled for 40 years. And so when you put 1,000 down, you are now archaeologically supported. Okay? All of this before that, they think it's this, but it's based on the ages of people listed in the Bible and so forth. Now's when this gets interesting. So, what happens to the kingdom? It splits into two parts. Anybody know the king of the north?
Yes.
Jeroboam
the first, actually. There were two of them. What's the name of the guy in the south?
Rehoboam,
yes. How many tribes in the north?
Ten.
How many in the south? Two, total of 12. Now, what happened to the north?
They were conquered by Assyria.
Assyria, very good.
Wait, we didn't talk about them earlier today, did we?
I think you did.
Why Mesopotamia?
The peanut gallery.
What's the big deal with that?
Anybody know the conquering king? Shalmaneser the fifth. Sorry, the box wasn't big enough.
How do you spell
that? Anybody know the year?
722.
722, very good.
Uh-oh.
Did you look this up on your phone?
No, I'm 20 years, I remember this.
Oh, well, man.
Just as clear as
remember like a steel trap.
Just
so it isn't getting rusty along the way.
Uh-huh.
Okay.
It's like Jeopardy.
Yeah, it's like Jeopardy.
Yeah, very good. Okie dokie, Smokey. What happens to the southern kingdom?
Babylon.
Yes, Babylon. And the king's name is? Nebuchadnezzar. And the year? 586. Very good.
Oh, that's the Mesopotamia thing again. What?
Yeah, say what? And that's when the temple was destroyed. Solomon's temple. Stood for almost 400 years, and then down it went. Okay, what's this gap here?
For 400 years.
Nope.
Not quite that much.
70 years.
Hey, gold star.
And it's the exile into Babylon. Now, we're having a good time here and cranking out all this history. For those of you going to the land, why is this so important for you to know this timeline? Because the guide is going to run up and down this timeline. Mm-hmm. And he's going to use things like Bronze Age 1, Iron Age 2, and he'll expect you to know what he's talking about. So if you're going to the land, you need to learn this thing. All right? And hopefully none of you are taking along your cheat sheet.
Emily.
I'm going to go back and add that. Okay? All whitey, silly webbit. Here we go. So what happens at the end of the 70-year exile? The temple is rebuilt. Does anybody know the name of the man who oversaw the rebuilding of the temple? Yeah, Zerubbabel. Very good. 516. And the Bible book written at the time is the book of Ezra. So when you get to the historic book Ezra, you're going to find Zerubbabel's name and a number of other guys. Haggai, Zechariah. Those guys all lived here at the end of that 70 years. Okay, what's next? I'm sorry, what?
The wall rebuilt? Did they rebuild the wall?
Yeah, the wall's rebuilt by Nehemiah. Very good. The year? 444 BC. That's when the decree was issued by Xerxes, the king, to allow him to go back to the land and rebuild the wall. Now, why would they rebuild the temple without a protection wall? That's crazy. Van, what do you think? Because they were under the protection of the Persians. It was the Persians' job. But then when the Persian king, Cyrus, comes along, he decides he's going to issue autonomy to a number of the provinces or states. And so what he did was gave Nehemiah the permission to rebuild the wall, which means they're now responsible for their own protection. Make sense now? Okay. Good. Who's next? What's next? I don't know who's on third. Okay, you Daniel scholars. We've talked about Babylon and Persia. Who's next?
Greeks.
Oh, the Greeks. And what was the guy's name?
Alexander.
Oh, good old Alexander the Great. Here's something interesting. Alexander the Great comes chariot riding into Jerusalem. He's going to conquer the city, right? The high priest meets him at the edge of the city and says, wait, hold on. Did you know you were predicted in one of our prophet books? And Alexander the Great is, I have an oracle from on high. Mm-hmm. So the high priest shows him the book of Daniel, mm-hmm. which describes him very clearly in the book of Daniel. And so Alexander the Great says, I'll make a deal with you. If you accept Greek culture, Greek language, then I will not decimate the city. And so they came to that agreement. And that's why at the time of Jesus, there were so many Jewish people living after Greek traditions. Okay? History.
Hellenization.
I'm sorry?
Hellenization.
Hellenization, that's exactly right. Okay, who's next? Not yet. There was a self-ruling group in there. Tim? The Hasmoneans. Sometimes called the Maccabees. The term Maccabee means hammer. So they're the Hasmoneans that hammered. Like Simon the Maccabee and Judas the Maccabee, etc., etc., etc. And then we have Rome. And the year is 63 AD. The Hasmoneans were lousy rulers. And so there were people in Israel didn't like the Hasmoneans. So they went to Rome and asked the Romans to come in and take over. So they did by invitation. The Roman general's name was Pompey the Great. And in 63, he conquered the land. And they set up Roman rule. And they were in control of things when the great Yeshua HaMashiach is born. Jesus the Messiah. So, now what's this thing up here on top? And what's the arrow? Well, from this time at the end of the book of Esther, there were no Bible books written and there were no prophets in the land. So we call those what? 400 silent years. Okay. If you can think this way now, we're going to add this. Tim asked about this a minute ago. Abraham, Bronze Age. That means most of the weapons and utilitarian items are made out of bronze or brass. Abraham. Whoops. Keep pushing the wrong button. Abraham, Bronze Age. Between Moses and the Kings, Iron Age 1. David, Iron Age 2. And I'm fairly certain the guide, although I haven't traveled with this guide before, will refer to those three metal time periods.
Do you know why they mentioned the metal period? It might seem like a silly question to ask. Okay. It's because that was the most hard metal that they had figured out how to use. Bronze was the hardest, and it was the one that they could. Bronze is unique because the more you pound on it, beat on it, that's what causes it to become strong and hold a sharp edge. Then they figured out how to make iron. So as they figured out, that's kind of an idea of where the technology is at. Does that make sense? Okay. And they can know that, yeah, we don't need to get a whole lot of details, but that was just a basic. So when they're talking about the different metals, the softer the metal that you're mentioning, the earlier it will be. Like, we're not talking about the titanium age right now, right? Okay, or the silicone age. So the Bronze Age would be earlier than an Iron Age, if you're
right.
Thinking about it that way. Does that make sense? Okay, for me, that knowing that always helped me to understand, okay, where am I at? I'm not great with knowing the eras either. Yeah, Tim?
Okay, before bronze was the stone age, and in the volcanic areas, the volcanic glass is what they used as spearheads.
Mm-hmm.
So you started with the volcanic glass and moved into the metals.
Neolithic is a term you'll hear from the Stone Age. Flintstones is another one you'll hear.
No, but it is flint that made the spearheads and the spearheads.
Yep.
Where would that be on the
Stone Age?
Well, before bronze.
Yeah,
Oh, yeah, all the way back into here.
Right into there, yeah.
So you got Iron Age 1, Iron Age 2, is that right?
Yes. I just put the two of them together. Soon as the guide says Iron Age, you just need to be thinking between Moses and David. If you got that, you're doing good.
Bronze Age is what again? Abraham?
Abraham, yeah.
By the way, one of the places that we see when we're in the north near Mount Hermon, says Rio Philippi, there is a city gate that is from the time of Abraham. And it is highly likely that Abraham would have actually gone through that very city gate.
Yeah, that's see, right.
Which is super cool. Sorry, nerding there. Okay. Were there any other metal ages we wanted to mention?
If we've got those ages right there, we're doing really well. You'll go there with knowledge enough to follow what the guide is saying.
Yep,
literally. Okay? Michael.
This is totally off topic, but on the one of the domes on one of the churches, do you know if that's iron or like steel? Like the gold domes on one of the churches?
No, the gold dome is not on a church. It's on a Islamic holy site. It's not even a mosque. That's called the Dome of the Rock. And archaeologists are about 99% agreed that's where the temple originally stood. So, and it's over a rock. They think the rock is where Abraham was told to sacrifice Isaac. So, okie dokie. And so, who's last?
Who's the last prophet before Jesus, guys? Do you know?
My wife let it out of the bags. John the Baptist. He's the last and the return of the prophets. Okay?
I know.
Yeah, Don.
Well, my question is, when did the Jewish when did the Jews become Jews? Was Adam and Eve Jewish? Was Noah a Jew? Were Jews then, all the way down.
No, you were all Gentiles.
Okay.
Everybody was Gentile until Abraham, and Abraham was the first, Jew by adoption. His son Isaac was the son of promise and was a Jew by birth. And so it's through the family line of Isaac and Jacob and the 12 tribes and so forth that the Jewish nation...
Well, how did they become a Jew? I mean, that's what I'm trying to find
circumcised.
Out.
Circumcised.
The covenant with
circumcised,
Abraham.
Circumcised. Yeah. Oh. The covenant of circumcision.
Okay.
Genesis chapter 17.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Isn't it with Abraham's descendants that we have Muslim and Jew, Gentile split? Because
flat-footed there, Tim.
The Muslims claim Abraham.
Okay, now I got you. All right. After Sarah died, Abraham got remarried. If you didn't know that, he married a slave girl by the name of Keturah, and she had 7 sons who became the head of the Arabic tribes as we now know them.
Ishmael.
And then you also have Ishmael, who was the son by Hagar, the handmaiden. So both the descendants of Ishmael and those 7 other sons to Keturah became the Arabic peoples. Right. And so that's why they say our Bible is full of mistakes, that Ishmael is actually the son of promise, not Isaac.
So what I'm trying to ask is, when did they become a Jew? So God said to Abraham, okay, I'm going to make you a Jew now. So from now
Genesis
on, you're 17. A Jew.
Genesis 17, Don.
Okay.
And that's when God says to Abraham, walk before me and be blameless. And then he tells him, you're to circumcise everybody in your household. And that's when Abraham says, I wish that Ishmael could be my main inheritor. And God says, no, it's going to be Isaac, who is born through your wife, Sarah, 1 year from now. And that's when Isaac was born. Isaac was then circumcised, became the first Jew by birth. Okay?
Right.
And then it's through Isaac, Jacob, the 12 tribes, and so forth, that Jewish heritage was then established. And that's when the land covenant promises passed from Abraham down through Isaac, Jacob, 12 tribes. And God repeated those covenantal promises to both Isaac and Jacob, and then to the 12 sons. Now, if you want some very interesting reading, Genesis 49, Jacob is about to die, and he makes prophecy blessings on the 12 sons. Guess which son got the largest blessing? Judah. Have you ever heard of the Lion of the Tribe of Judah? Yeah. And if you read that prophecy in Genesis 49, it becomes very clear that Jesus is the subject being talked about there. It's amazing. Okay? All right. Now we're going to zip through the bottom timeline, and we're going to take another break before we finish up with one other little project.
Hold on. I thought we were waiting on that one for the next class.
What?
New Testament timeline is the next class, the next time we get together,
yeah,
isn't it?
I generally do the whole thing.
I love carrots. I like, keeps you coming back for more.
Yeah, well.
I mean, you can do what you want. I was just,
well,
I was surprised.
So where are we on this timeline now? We're somewhere in here. And there is a clear time predicted in both Daniel, other minor prophets, and Book of Revelation, 1st and 2nd Thessalonians, a 7-year time period called the Great Tribulation, or the time of God's wrath. Then there's the millennial or messianic kingdom. You can use either term. Book of Revelation says that there will be a time when Satan is released again. He's locked up during this messianic kingdom. The Flip Wilson statement will not stand. Oh, the devil made me do it. Not. Then you have the Great White Judgment, called the Great White Throne, Revelation 19, I believe, 20 maybe. I never remember that number very well. Then finally, eternity. That is the entire Bible, historically and prophetically, all on one page.
This kind of timeline before, it's a wonderful thing to just keep with your Bible. So if you're reading somewhere and you're like, wait a minute, how does that fit, like, pull out this paper and it helps you kind of figure out where you're at.
All right, now I'm going to make one more addition to the timeline that's not on yours. Did you know that all of the biblical writing prophets go from here to here? From the split of the kingdom to the restoration of the kingdom. All right, did you know that the four major prophets, Isaiah is the prophet during the fall of the north. Jeremiah, Ezekiel, and Daniel are the three prophets of the fall of the south. They're the most writing information. You know, it kind of makes me think God is concerned about the destruction of his kingdom. Lending credence, if you please, to this idea of a millennial kingdom or a messianic kingdom down here. After a while, it all kind of starts making sense. So I'm going to repeat that now. 722, Isaiah. That's Isaiah. 722. 586, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, and Daniel. Thank you. Okay, Hope, I'm going to ask you to erase that. We're going to put one more thing on the board, and then this has been a lot of heavy stuff today. Okay, we're going to do one more thing. That'll give you a hint as to where we're going with the next class. But you're going to take a while to absorb this. So our next class is in March.
Yep.
All right.
What's the exact date for the next class? March 21?
Yeah, March 21. Okay. In order to unlock much that's in the scripture, there are three things you need to know. Number one, Messiah. Jesus. Did you know that there are over 300 predictions in the Old Testament that identify Jesus? There's 333 is the actual number. 333 predictions written to identify the Messiah before he ever showed up. Do you know he's the only person in human history that that could be said of? You can't say that about Napoleon or George Washington or Hitler. Only Jesus. 300 predictions written before he was born. Number two, Jewish festivals. God's calendar.
Prophetic calendar.
God's calendar. Both historic and prophetic. God's calendar. And there's a lot to say about the Jewish festivals, which we'll get to next time. And number three, the temple. The temple is the place. Now, in parentheses about the temple, hope if you put five temples in parentheses.
Okay, check it out.
Woo! Thank you, Siri.
Now, I will explain all of that when we study the temple. I teach an ABF in this room. And I just spent the past 3 weeks looking at the temple. What's it all about? What does it mean that you and I have become the temple of the Holy Spirit? And it's directly connected to all of these elements involved with the temple here. And I think you may find that it has a wonderful influence on your life. Now, my last thing, and then we can wrap up, put the room back where it goes, and so forth. I am not Jewish. I have no need to be Jewish. I will never become Jewish. The closest I get is Jewish by adoption. But I study these things because they unfold or reveal truth in the scriptures that the authors of the Bible assume that you would know, and you probably don't. Okay? All right. There's a great interest today with the rebirth of Israel and so forth of people studying these Jewish backgrounds. And what ends up happening is they get sucked right back into obeying a whole new level of the law. And what it does is it destroys their spirit. You know, I even have some former students that have gotten involved in that. One young lady was a very close friend, actually converted back from her Christian faith to Judaism, is obeying all of those ancient laws and so forth. And I saw her about a year and a half ago, and she looked so unhappy. So that's a warning. Be very careful with this information, okay? It says in Galatians 5, the book that Paul wrote about, don't go back to the law. Galatians 5 says, it is for freedom that you have been set free. That means that the Holy Spirit is the key to your spiritual growth, development, and strength. And in the end of that chapter 5, fruit of the Spirit, that ought to tell you something. Yeah.
Okay? All right. I'm going to ask Hope if she would close in prayer, and then I'll explain what we need to do to clean up here today. Thank you.
Hi, guys. When you thought 4 hours of learning about Bible stuff, how many of you were feeling, you made what? You guys have been great today. A couple of announcements, and then we'll close up for the day. This has been great. First of all, if you picked up a manual, but you didn't pay for it, you can still pay for it. Just make sure you make a check out to Don Bechtel and give the check actually to my mother. Yeah, you can pay him later as long as he has a record of who has it, or you can just hand it back in and you can contact us to purchase it at any time. The next time we get together, classes 3 and 4, the morning sessions will be talking about all of this. How does Jesus fit into everything we learned about today?
What's the time to start?
Same time, 10 o'clock.
Okay.
And I promise we'll have coffee next time and tea and all the hot beverages. I apologize, that was my fault. We didn't have that taken care of today. One other quick thing, if you're a person who's going on tour, walking is your friend, okay? When you go on a 2-week-long trip and you are on your feet, clocking between 6 and 7 miles of walking every day, not fast, and between 12 and 14 flights of stairs throughout your day, because Israel is not flat. Okay, people have worn their Fitbits the last 3 times I've gone, and that is the average amount of walking that we do. It's never super fast, but it is about endurance. So if you're a person who doesn't walk a lot, here's what I would say. Here's a very easy, practical goal. If you can get to the point where you're walking a mile a couple times a week, 2-3 times a week by the end of March, 2 miles a couple times a week by the end of April, 3 miles a couple times a week by the end of May, you will be fine, okay? We got a lot of parks in the area, use them. Being outside, again, it's not about how fast you go, but it's about, listen, the more you walk, the more you physically prepare, the more you will enjoy your trip, okay? And I'm going to pray about that, actually. Then one last thing. Okay, class number 3 is about Jesus and how he fits into everything we just talked about today. We'll be getting into more detail on the Jewish festivals and the temple, which is really exciting. And then we'll break for lunch. We'll have some excellent food again, but we're going to have some different stuff. I don't know what that is yet, but yeah. If you enjoyed what you had today, we'll have some other things. And then in the afternoon, we're going to answer all of your burning questions about how do I handle being on a plane for a long time? How do I get through security? What do I need to pack? How much can I pack? What should I, shouldn't I? I will be talking all about packing and tips and tricks. I have it all documented, written down, and so if you have questions on that. But if you have questions that you're like, you know what, I'd like to start working on that now, you can send me emails and I'll be more than glad to help you. Questions? Yes, Tim?
In the back of the book, there's a lot of stuff about.
Yes, but the stuff in the back of the book, I would say there's more current, easier ways to do things, and I took everything that was in the back of that and updated it for 2020. Because some of the things that it talked about was film, and we don't do films, or international calling cards. If you have a smartphone, there's really cool, cheap, as in free, ways to be able to contact people back here in the States. Every hotel has Wi-Fi, so there are ways to be in contact with your family. No problem. Okay. All right. So let me close us. Yes, Dad.
One more thing. I was asked about when the money needs to be paid to the pilgrim tours to pay for the trip.
Yeah. You can be making payments now, and then, by the way, there are still spots open. It's not too late to register. If you know of anyone who is praying about being a part of the tour, they are still more than welcome. Yeah, Pilgrim Tours, you work with them individually if you contact them. They just finalized the invoicing based on the 20 that are registered, okay? So, but if more people join, that will lower the price. Okay, because here's the thing. Everybody's flight costs the same. Everybody's room costs the same. But the cost of your tour guide is divided between the people going. And he's a certain amount of money per day. And so the more people that go, that's why the price goes down, because we're dividing his total cost between everybody that's going, or paying him for his scholarship and his time.
And the bus cost.
And the and the cost of the bus, exactly. Yeah. So it's one bus that we're dividing between 20 people right now for 2 weeks, but if we divide it between 30 people, that drops the price a lot for everybody. Does that make sense? Okay. So let me close this in prayer, and we'll just enjoy the rest of our day. Lord, we are so thankful for you. We are so thankful for your truth, your goodness, how you are so in all of those details of connecting things thousands of years ago to right now. And Lord, I know there's been a lot of information today, and I just ask that you would lock those things into our minds and our spirits that you want us to take away from today. Ease any worries or anxiousness and replace it with peace and joy and excitement. Lord, you know the people you've called to join us on this tour this summer, and I'm so excited already meeting the spirited people that you've gathered together in this group, and we bless that. Lord, we ask for your abundance in finances, that you would bless the courageous hearts that are stepping out in faith, saying, yes, Lord, we trust that you are providing for our needs, and we are trusting that even if I don't see where every last penny is coming from, I trust you're going to make it happen. So, Lord, we bless that. We bless you, and we love you. Amen.
Hey, oh,
yes.
Are you going to talk next time about how this finances to be paid before we go?
They should be contacting you. The federal tours.
Not done yet.
Okay, you can make payments to Pilgrim Tours at any time. If you need...
Isn't there a sequence whether you can pay so much at a time or half a time or all of it or whatever?
Yeah, it's up to you. The final payment is not due until the end of March. But if you want to be paying little bits now, like whenever you can just send money now. And then the final invoice that they send you will be whatever you have left to pay. Does that make any sense?
Okay. So yes and no.
Which means you can pay some now.
Make it out to Pilgrim's Tour or whatever?
Yes.
And the address and everything?
How about this? Those of you who are going on the tour, don't panic about payments. Let me contact Jessica, who is our representative there, and I will send an email with exact information on what to do.
That's good.
Way you can read it, yeah. And then if you still have questions, you can let me know.
All right.
Okay? Yes, Tim.